Hachette Audio presents Duped, Double Lives, False Identities, and The Con Man I Almost Married. Written by Abby Ellin. Read by Therese Plummer. 4. My Mother, Who Was Right from the Beginning. Chapter 1. Gaslit, A Love Story. The truth will set you free, but first it will piss you off. Gloria Steinem. Maybe. My ex-fiancé orchestrated the raid on Osama bin Laden. He received a Purple Heart for his military service and a Medal of Honor from Golda Meir, which he tucked neatly away in a private vault. He thwarted a bioterrorism attack in New York City and saved the grandson of one of the world's wealthiest men from an attempted kidnapping. That I know all this is a privilege in itself. None of it was public. He wasn't in it for glory. He made guest appearances at major events but refused the acclaim or even a paycheck. He didn't write a book about his escapades or sell his story to Hollywood. His goal wasn't to become rich and famous, but to keep his children and all of America safe from the bad guys. "I'm not going to sit by while people are in danger," he'd often say as he packed his bags for a secret mission. It was wonderfully noble, except for one minor detail. None of it was true. Let's rewind to early 2006, when I was reading a newspaper article on detox diets. Those lemon and hot water cleanses said to eradicate toxins, inflammation, cellulite, and hangnails. I needed an expert to tell me if they were at all legitimate. Someone recommended a doctor with a posh Beverly Hills practice. I'm most comfortable interviewing people remotely, from behind the warm, safe glow of my computer screen. The roles are clear. I ask questions, and the other person answers them. So it went with the doctor. He told me that adherents of detox programs ran the risk of hypervitaminosis. These diets were, in essence, bullshit, he said. He had me at hypervitaminosis. The quote made it into the story, but the article was put on indefinite hold. Nearly a year later, when the piece was finally slated to run, I called the doctor to fact check. Had anything changed? Was he still in Los Angeles? No, he said. I'm in the military now, a Navy doc. He had quit his lucrative practice and moved to Jacksonville, Florida to work at a naval hospital. How can you be in the military? I teased. You're Jewish. He lobbed the ball right back at me. There are 7 of us, he deadpanned. I'd never known anyone who'd joined the military in later life, but then I'd never known anyone in the military. The doctor told me he'd served years earlier and had re-enlisted in order to open a hospital in Iraq for kids with cancer. He was a lieutenant commander. Soon he would start a job at the Pentagon. What a coincidence. I was planning on moving to the capital to attend graduate school at Johns Hopkins School of Advanced International Studies for what I half-jokingly dubbed my second useless master's. I wanted to write about global human rights issues, and this hospital project was a story worth pursuing. Keep me posted, I said. And so he did, emailing every few months with snippets of information. His emails were laden with medical jargon and slightly odd. The language was indecipherable to me. But I was still interested in the story, so I responded enthusiastically. In December 2009, the emails began picking up in frequency. By late January, they had blossomed into daily, almost hourly, telephone calls. Apparently, he too had felt a connection during our initial call. He confessed to visiting my website and watching various television interviews I'd done. You looked great in that green dress, he said, referring to my appearance on a morning TV show. He waxed poetic on my sternal notch, the indentation in the middle of the clavicle. We spoke deeply, honestly. The commander, as I took to calling him, was 58, a former Navy SEAL, divorced a few years earlier. His two children, then 5 and 12, lived on the West Coast with his ex-wife. It hadn't been an amicable split, but he spoke to his kids often and visited frequently. I told him about my ambivalence toward relationships, how they were really not my area of expertise. I just emerged from a brief and disappointing dalliance with a guy I'd known at summer camp. I'd been trying so hard to find a good man, I hadn't even cared that he was a Wall Street Republican who played fantasy football. I'm not going to learn anything or grow spiritually from another failed romance, I told the commander. I've paid my dues. It's time for something good.
I understand, he said. I've suffered enough too.
The demise of his marriage had been excruciating, which was why he'd fled LA.
I couldn't stand the breakup of my family, he told me. I couldn't bear to live in the city of my failure. The Navy saved me.
Moving across the country from your adored young children didn't seem like father knows best behavior to me, but I don't have kids and have not endured a divorce. We're all so fragile in our own unique ways. Anyway, it seemed like a good sign that his ex-wife was open to him spending so much time with his kids. And I was impressed that he was so loyal to the country. Such passion, such dedication. He didn't care about money. He cared about people. One of the main issues in his marriage, in fact, had been that he wasn't earning enough to placate his ex. She sounded like such a diva. Both she and the other doctors in his office, he was a partner there, had pressured him to refuse Medicaid patients. But he wouldn't.
I'm not going to turn people away just because they can't afford it, he said.
On our first date, in early February 2010, he took me to the Four Seasons in Manhattan.
Somewhere celebratory, as he'd put it.
I wore a gray silk dress and thigh-high black suede boots. He'd just come from addressing the United Nations and was in navy whites. We embraced as if he were returning from Iwo Jima. The bartender was so moved that he plied us with free drinks. Red wine for me, vodka for him. As a present, the commander brought me a white navy cap. A cover, in military parlance. I slipped it on, feeling like Deborah Winger in An Officer and a Gentleman. Granted, he was no Richard Gere. I'd only seen a few photos of him online, and most were from a distance. In person, he looked a decade younger. But his nose was beakish, and he had an overbite and a mouthful of cap teeth. His shoulders hunched forward when he walked, as if he were mid-bow. He suffered from asthma and squirted nasal spray in public. But his smile was bright and wide, and his hair, though slightly receding, was a beautiful black and silver. He had not a centimeter of fat on his body, and he was entranced with me. Later, over seared tuna and Pinot Noir, he confessed that the great trauma of his life was not becoming a brain surgeon, his true calling. He'd wanted to treat glioblastomas, one of the deadliest types of brain tumors, but he hadn't received any surgical fellowships. My grandmother had died of the same cancer. How weird. This hospital project was his chance to hit the reset button.
Who gets to start over at my age?
He beamed. Then he told me that during the previous summer, he'd been the medical director at Guantanamo, treating high-level terrorists. He lowered his voice. At Gitmo, a country club for bad guys, one of his patients was a very important terrorist. He gave me a rundown of the VIT's medical history. Kidney trouble, diabetes, enlarged heart. Bin Laden? That made no sense to me. If it were true, wouldn't the president want to take credit for his capture? That would guarantee re-election. Besides, a secret that big would never remain that way.
The president doesn't know, he said.
That seemed even more absurd.
I told him that was a stupid thing to tell a journalist.
It's not verifiable,
he said.
I'd deny it. It would be my word against yours.
When I pressed further, he backpedaled.
Maybe it wasn't bin Laden. All I know is what they told me.
You would know what he looked like. He's 6'6".
They all look alike,
he said. His glance never wavered.
Every so often, he still did undercover work. Black ops in conjunction.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.